Bibles as we begin this new year to Matthew chapter 15. Quite a remarkable passage with which to begin the new year, and I pray that we learn much from it. Matthew 15. We're going to read verses 21 through 28. Before we do that, let me remind all of us, if you have a cell phone, please check it and make sure that it's on quiet. I don't think we have new families with little ones. Probably don't have to repeat our provision for little ones that need to be quieted down. Let me simply encourage all of you, if your little one needs to be quieted down, please, you can take them in that the very next room over and quiet them. And for our nursing mothers, I'm very glad to hear, even from visiting mothers, we now have a nursing mother's room to be spread abroad, to be talked about. I was grateful to have some visitors recently, actually thrilled after spending the service in our nursing mother's room. So it was our purpose to be a blessing to our nursing mothers. We do pray it is a great encouragement to all of you that do that holy endeavor. It is quite surprising to many of us, by the way, that several of the Puritan works on family have not only paragraphs and pages, but some of them entire chapters on the importance of breastfeeding. I can't remember the last time I've heard anybody even mention it other than the mothers that we have here. Imagine someone writing an entire chapter and showing from Scripture the glory and the beauty of it. Not making that a law for everyone, by the way. Simply saying it is plainly set forth in Scripture and a blessing. Now, with all of that said, let's take Matthew 15, verses 21 through 28, and give our attention to them. Please stand with me. Matthew 15, beginning in verse 21. Oh, brethren, what a blessing to begin the year standing together, hearing God's word. Amen. Let's give our attention to it. Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coasts of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, Truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Amen. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of His Word. If it is difficult for you to continue standing, please be seated. Otherwise, we will stand together on this blessed first day of the new year and lift our hearts as one to the living God. O our blessed Father, how we praise and thank Thee for the Lord's Day, that market day of the soul. How we thank Thee for the holy celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. How we thank Thee, O God, that every Lord's Day is a precious remembrance of Christ's resurrection, that all history changed in that extraordinary moment when He left the tomb. Oh God, how we praise and thank Thee that we worship a living God, that we do not bow down before sticks and stones and idols made of men's hands and carried about on men's shoulders. That we do not worship the trees or the mountains or the clouds or the sun or the moon or the heavenly host. But that Thou hast revealed Thyself to us in Thy holy Son, Jesus Christ. Blessed be Thy holy name. How we thank Thee today for a great Savior, a glorious Savior, a full, complete Savior. O Christ, Thou art the fountain, the deep, sweet well of love, the streams on earth we've tasted, more deep we'll drink above. And Father, we are one day closer to that holy drink. How we long to see our Christ, to see Him in His glory. For our eyes finally to gaze upon what they were made for. To see the splendor, the majesty, the glory of our God. To see Him face to face. Oh, what a day. O Christ, wouldst Thou grant us just a little taste of that today? As we gaze upon Thee in this passage, wouldst Thou draw near to Thy bride? Thou hast said that Thou would. We stand upon this precious book. We stand upon its promise. Through Thy mouthpiece, Thou hast told us, if we draw nigh to Thee, Thou wilt draw nigh to us. Oh, may we not drift. Father, even if in our prayer right now we're drifting, draw us back to the throne of grace, and may our hearts beat as one, praising and magnifying Thee. We thank Thee for all that Thou hast done in bringing us through this last year. Father, what great glories, so many things to praise and thank Thee for, and what great sorrows that Thou didst bring us, and yet how we can thank Thee for them as well, for in them Thou didst show Thy great goodness, Thy sustaining grace. How we thank Thee, O Lord, that Thou didst spare Danny McCurdy on Friday. O God, how I am thankful that we're not planning a funeral. Lord, that we can begin this year with true praise at seeing Thy extraordinary work before us. And Father, as Thou hast rescued several from sickness and car wrecks, Lord, our sister Sayori and others with conditions, O Lord, Thou hast kept us through the whole year. And we thank Thee for this. And Father, as we come into this new year with joy in anticipation of seeing Thy hand move we know that it will all come through that blessed channel, through that glorious conduit, the Lord Jesus. Every blessing we have will come through our precious Master. Lord Jesus, we welcome Thee here this morning. Bless Thy dear sheep. Now, Father, there are so many things we could pray about. We could pray throughout the day. But now, O Lord, we come with one last earnest request, and that is that Thou rend the heavens and come down. Come down. Pour out Thy Spirit in the preaching of Thy Word. Meet with Thy people. Get glory to Thy great name. Save the lost. Sanctify the saved. And turn every heart, every eye of faith on Jesus Christ our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Brethren, please be seated. What a remarkable transition from verses 1 through 20 to the text we have just read. In the previous scene, one, Pharisees and scribes from Jerusalem questioned the orthodoxy of the Lord Jesus Christ and His disciples. Two, Jesus deconstructed their false doctrine and publicly humiliated them. And three, the disciples proved again how little they really understood their Master and His teaching, which should humble all of us. How well do we know our great Savior? How well do we know His teaching? We can grow in both. Now, from the unbelieving religious leaders to the tradition-instructed crowds, to His confused disciples, Jesus taught that godliness does not begin with external things, and that the true source of all defilement is not outside us, but inside us, the human heart. Now, we want to bear this in mind as we take up a real contrast, a persevering mother's faith. Our title is A Mother's Persevering Faith, and it is my hope for this new year that the Holy Spirit will come in power, that God our Father will be pleased for the Spirit to illuminate us, to grasp our hearts, not turn loose, and fix us on Christ as we see Him here, and that we might learn from our Master. May all that we do here exalt Jesus Christ. Now, with that in mind, Jesus traveled from promised land to pagan land. Our sacred text says, Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. Now, the first thing to consider about what appears to just be part of the story, a few details to round out the lesson. No. The lesson begins in this verse. We miss that. We miss a great deal of what Christ is going to teach us. This is not just background. It's the very foundation of the whole lesson. From promised land to pagan land. So the first thing to take up under this heading is that Jesus and his disciples left Gennesaret. In Matthew's gospel, the Greek word translated departed usually occurs in scenes of opposition, danger, even death. For instance, in chapter 2, verse 12, we read of the wise men being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod. They departed into their own country another way. Then Joseph learned of Herod's plan to slaughter Jesus. And he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt. When the Pharisees of Capernaum planned to destroy our Savior after he healed a man in the synagogue, Jesus withdrew, same Greek word, withdrew himself from thence. Now, we could multiply examples of this. But the point, I trust, is clear. Following the opposition that Jesus just received from the Jerusalem Pharisees and Sadducees, he wisely withdrew from his enemies, rejecting them in their unbelief. He had completed his Galilean ministry. But then he did something unusual. And I trust we've learned to expect that from the Lord Jesus. He does not fit in our box. In fact, what he does is startling. Jesus and his disciples traveled to the regions of Tyre and Sidon. And what's so unusual about this? Well, we must remember that Jesus had just been in a powerful confrontation with the Pharisees and scribes over defilement and ritual purity. But following this, he traveled directly into the region of two well-known pagan cities, centers, nests of uncleanness, of defilement. Jesus wasn't concerned about outward things as such, unless they rose from inward love for God. He had no problem going into these cities. Jesus traveled directly into the region of these two well-known pagan cities, Tyre and Sidon, which were 30 and 50 miles northwest of Gennesaret in the pagan territory of Phoenicia. In the Old Testament, these cities were infamous for their pagan pride arising from their great wealth and strategic locations along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. Tyre and Sidon were ancient cities. Tyre is mentioned in Joshua chapter 19, verse 29, as the strong city, Tyre, and in 2 Samuel 24, 7, as the stronghold of Tyre. Sidon was founded by Canaan's firstborn son, named Sidon. And in Joshua, it is called Great Sidon. Sometimes it begins with an S and sometimes it begins with a Z. Same place. And you will read much about the Sidonians throughout the Old Testament. And while these two cities were located in Canaan, in the Promised Land, Israel never conquered them. If you go back and read Joshua carefully, God commanded His people to clear the land of all the pagans, of all the Canaanites. And they were disobedient. They didn't do that. They never conquered these cities. And they became bitter, bitter enemies at various times in their history. Sometimes Tyre worked along with King David and King Solomon, as you read in Kings and Chronicles, Samuel and Kings Chronicles. You will see in these books that there was an allegiance, at least for a short period of time, between David, Solomon, and the king of Tyre. But they were a thorn in Israel's side. Now, the Jews knew that. We could read this and say, Tyre and Sidon, ancient cities, if we gave it that much thought, and move on to the meaty stuff. No, this is the meaty stuff. Right here. The Jews instantly understood what Tyre and Sidon meant. Both cities were centers of dishonest merchants, sexual immorality, and especially that sin of sins, idolatry. In the book of Judges, the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of the Lord and served Balaam and Ashtaroth and the gods of Syria and the gods of Sidon. If they had obeyed the Lord, they wouldn't have fallen captured to Sidon's gods. But because they didn't, they fell into that great sin. Ezekiel rebuked the king of Tyre, who was known for his satanic pride. He's even a figure of Satan in the Old Testament. Because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas. Yet thou art a man, says God, and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of God. God then tells him, when the one that slays you does so, you won't look like God. And Sidon was the home of Jezebel, a Baal worshiper. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Joel, all of these prophets preached against Tyre and Sidon. Huge portions. They declared God's wrath on these arrogant, wicked cities. They were proverbial. Proverbial in their sin, their grotesque wickedness. And this is what makes Jesus' condemnation of Galilee in Matthew 11:21 so powerful. Woe unto you, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. If we understand at least a little bit about Tyre and Sidon at this point, that's an astonishing statement. And it tells you the unspeakable darkness that the Jews were in. Pagans would have seen what Christ was manifesting from city to city, and repented. God did not give them that opportunity. He did to Israel. And by and large, they did not repent. So Jesus left Gennesaret, the promised land, briefly for Tyre and Zidon, pagan land. Our second major thought is this. A Gentile woman from that region pleaded with Jesus for mercy on her daughter, but he ignored her. What a thought. Verses 22 through 24, the inspired text says, "And behold," and remember, as we go through Matthew's gospel, when he says, "Behold," that's a literary device. He picks this up because it's all through the Old Testament, and he applies it in his gospel. When he says, "Behold," that's a sign marker. In other words, he's saying, pay attention. There's something remarkable. I'm drawing your eyes to this. Jesus has just gone, if it wasn't remarkable enough, into pagan land. And now behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil." There is nothing in this world, nothing in this world, quite like a mother's heart. And men don't get that very often, unfortunately. What can compare, what, to her tender, determined, and relentless passion when her heart's desire is to ease her suffering child's misery? We have some wonderful fathers here. I know that there are some fathers here that will get up in the middle of the night to help sick children. But I remember all of my days. If I was up, burning up with fever, it was my mother at my side, cooling me down. If I was throwing up, it was her standing behind me, holding me. A mother's heart is an extraordinary place. It is a very special blessing from God. And here's a mother on a desperate mission. Her daughter doesn't have a cold, a sore throat, and of course, mothers are always right there helping their children, often catching their diseases and having to continue to care for them while they're sick. Her child doesn't have the measles or the mumps. She is possessed with a foul, unclean devil, a demon. Now that doesn't just happen. Children don't just get demon possessed. Their parents open the door for it by their activities. We know that Jesus himself asked a grieving father, "How long has he been this way?" Of a child. It doesn't just happen. Brethren, this woman's background is generations of pagans. When we go to heathen, pagan, non-Christian nations, it isn't unusual to find children that are demon-possessed. We've gotten to where in our country, We've got plenty of them and don't recognize it because their parents have thrown the door wide open. The 60s was a gate thrown open that hell has been vomiting from since, all the way up to our capital. Listen, brethren, things like this don't just happen. And this woman has seen the horrific effects upon her children, her child. We don't know if she had others. We can only imagine with the idolatry for which Tyre and Zidon was known, how many people became actually demonized to the recognizable point. Listen, people don't have to be, quote, possessed to be powerfully under Satan's rule. That's how we're described in Ephesians 2. We're children of wrath outside of Christ, under the prince of the power of the air. We are in a real battle that is not flesh and blood. And this woman is seeing a grosser manifestation of that evil. Our brother prayed on Wednesday evening and on the last Lord's Day that we would be careful what we bring into our homes. That's an important prayer. So, we have a very important woman in front of us, a mother on a great mission. Now, this is a pagan woman in a pagan land. This Canaanite woman sought out Christ and pleaded for her demonized daughter. Matthew does not give us this little detail, but Mark does. And he says, from thence he arose, Gennesaret, and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into a house, and would have no man know it. But he could not be hid. Tyre had been one of Israel's bitterest enemies, as we have already seen. So Jesus' decision to go into that region is surprising. Perhaps he went there to rest, which seemed to be the case by Mark. We wouldn't know that from Matthew. But to rest and to avoid the religious leaders, knowing that they would never enter such an unclean territory. They're back at home arguing about Jesus' disciples washing their hands. Mark adds that the woman heard of him. She heard of him and came and fell at his feet. So this pagan region had heard of Christ's astonishing preaching and miracles. We know this because Mark chapter 3 verse 8 affirms it. From Jerusalem and from Idumea and from beyond Jordan, and they about Tyre and Sidon, a great multitude, when they had heard what great things he did, came unto him. The good news of the kingdom had penetrated pagan land, as it's supposed to. And Luke affirms the very same. A great multitude of people out of all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Now, Matthew does describe this woman in a way that the other Gospels do not. She was a woman of Canaan, Once again, that's not just a tidbit, just a little bit of clothing on the story to leave us without just raw bones. But Matthew uses this term to emphasize that she was a Gentile. Again, these are the kind of things that Jews would pick up instantly. We Gentiles miss a lot of those things. But he wants us, he wanted his Jewish readers, he wanted to emphasize to them and to his readers throughout the ages that she was a pagan, a descendant of ancient Israel's enemies. These are the things that would be clear. And Mark tells us just a little bit more. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation. Now this too emphasizes the same thing. She's a Gentile. The idea of Greek often simply meant Gentile, Gentile of any sort. She was born in Phoenicia, a province of Syria. Pagan, pagan, and more pagan. Now this scene then is remarkable. If we grasp this just a little bit, pagan woman in a pagan land, then this unfolds remarkably. First, this is a woman. A Gentile woman. No respectable rabbi in Jesus' day would have associated with her. Secondly, this pagan woman from a pagan land cries out, shouts out to Jesus for help. Imman, one of the gods of the Zidonians, was a healing god and had a gigantic temple for healing in Sidon. She didn't go there. She comes to Jesus. Have mercy on me. And how does she address him? O Lord, thou son of David, my daughter is grievously vexed with a devil. And we must not miss the stark contrast that Matthew has hoisted up before us. This pagan woman shouts out to Jesus, calling him Lord and Son of David. Now, both titles can be simply a term of respect. Either one of them can simply be terms of respect. And they're used that way in Scripture in several places. But she's not just greeting him. She is continuously shouting for mercy, for deliverance for her demon-possessed daughter. This woman was clearly familiar with the Jews' hope of a coming Messiah. And she apparently believes that Jesus is Israel's Messiah. Precisely what Israel doesn't believe. Look at the contrast. The Jews, their leaders, your boys here don't wash their hands. Why don't they do that? And this woman comes calling him Messiah. Son of David. The contrast between the pagan woman and the Jews is remarkable. Remarkable. Now, she is crying to the Lord Jesus Christ. And she is believing What level? We don't know. But she calls him Lord. Again, that can simply be a polite sir. But she's pleading for her daughter. It would seem that the very urgency of it displays that she understands at least a bit more than just being sir. Brethren, it's obvious that she believes, she has faith that Jesus has authority over devils. She believes it. And she calls him what the Pharisees won't, Son of David. And she comes in humility, which the Pharisees never showed. Never. By the way, that should speak to us right here before we get to applications. God's people sometimes aren't very humble. Oh, if there should be a humble people on the planet, it's those that understand the sovereign grace of God. Well, we can say that she certainly apparently believes that Jesus is Israel's Messiah. And furthermore, there are no good cases of demonization, but this was an especially grievous vexation. Severe oppression, cruel affliction. We don't know the greatness of it, but the Greek is very strong here. We know that the demons can render men mindless, like the Gadarene demoniac. We know that he can take a child and cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy it. This child was grievously vexed, and this woman wasn't just trying another possibility. She believed that Jesus had supernatural authority over the wicked spirit that had her daughter enslaved. Her mother's heart was bursting in anguish. Can you only imagine when she would start hearing that sound? As she began to groan and make horrible, grievous, filthy, demonic noise. And she'd hear it again and she'd know. How long will it go? She wasn't just trying to get some temperature down. Her own daughter would become monstrous. The contortions or the twisting or the screaming or the convulsions. She was desperate, y'all. And this dear woman cries out to the Christ. She heard that he was in her region. So she went to seek him. The tense of the verb cried means that she was continuous, persistent. She didn't say, well, you know, my daughter's having some problems here. Could you help a little bit? This is a woman pleading, and she keeps pleading. Help me. Help me. Please, Lord, Son of David, help me. Help me. Help me. Help my daughter. And with this in mind, my dear brethren, stop and think. Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. We read, when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion upon them. Chapter 14, verse 14. where we read again that he saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion. I mean, Jesus is moved. And he healed their sick. And later in this chapter, we will hear Christ say, I have compassion on the multitude. And when he said it, he meant it. So how did God's compassionate Son, the Christ, respond to a pleading woman? Jesus ignored her. Do we know that Jesus? This Jesus doesn't get preached very much. But Jesus ignored her. Despite this desperate mother's cry, it must have been pitiful, pitiable. My daughter is grievously vexed with a demon. We read, but he answered her not a word. Well, this did not stop her. Some people at that point would just throw up their hands. Not this woman. She apparently turned to the disciples. I've been pleading with him. Can you help me? Help me. Can you talk to him for me? And what about the disciples? Well, the disciples showed no compassion. This mother's grieving heart burned for her suffering child. It was bursting for her child. She obviously continued crying out. And again, the Greek word can literally be translated, shouted, help me! Help me! Help me! And what did these men do? Were their hearts melted? Oh, Jesus, help this woman. No, in spite of her persistence and intensity, the disciples besought Jesus. The word here means urged. It can even mean begged. They begged him, send her away. Send her away, for she crieth after us. Now, it's true, this is a little ambiguous. Children, that means it can be understood in more than one way. There are those who would say that the disciples could have meant by this, number one, send her away without granting her request. She's annoying us. Or, number two, it could mean, please grant her request and send her away. J.C. Ryle says here, sometimes the Lord's people do not show their master's compassion. We can be disappointing sometimes, brethren, and I pray that we will grow in our compassion. But in this very context, it appears that they're following their master. He completely ignored her. She's pleading, apparently, with them. This is argued about in some of the commentaries. But whatever the case fully is, their place, their mind is send her away. Once again, just as a footnote, I hate to say it, but sometimes men, even Christian men, are, I'll use a popular word, insensitive. very often we simply do not understand a woman's grieving. To the few males left in our country that have been brought up to be men and not just selfish game players, even though sometimes, having been taught to be men, don't exactly understand what crushes a woman. Men can get in a fist fight and walk out of the room arm in arm. That doesn't always happen between men and women. And I don't mean the fist fight. I mean, even in a verbal fight, that thing can come back up 5 years later. I remember back in 2009 when you said that green dress made me look big. Or something else very sensitive. So, I'm very sorry that men often miss what they do. That's one of the reasons we believe in reforming men and women. But having given that extended footnote, we come back to the text. It is difficult to know which of the ways we're to understand their request, but as I said, the bottom line is send her out of here. Send her away. I tend to think that it's the first one. Send her away without granting her request. She's annoying us because their very master has not even spoken to her. I would think the context could go that way. But stop and think. What a monumental roadblock towered before this woman. She's apparently alone. It would seem from Mark's account that the daughter is at home. But she had heard of Jesus the healer and had come seeking his help, and he ignored her. And his disciples were begging him to send her away. What do you think that would do? Ladies, what would you think? Here's the great healer. Here's his backup. And they're all going, Jesus is saying nothing, and they're saying, send her away. Would you be encouraged by that? What would you be? What would you be thinking? What would your thoughts be about the great healer? Well, this woman was extraordinary. She kept at it. You know, if the two things that I just mentioned were not enough to discourage her, Jesus then declared the focus of his mission. Our Lord answered the disciples' plea by answering, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, since the woman had continued her pleading with the disciples, she was probably within earshot of Christ's statement. There's nothing in the text that says that she's now away from them and they're over just talking in the corner. It is quite likely that she heard Jesus say to them, I'm not come, or I'm not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Well, this is perplexing. Since the woman had continued her pleading, she hasn't stopped. And because Jesus had ignored her first plea, it might have come to their minds when Jesus had sent them to declare the good news of the kingdom throughout Galilee, that he had specifically commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now Jesus is conforming perfectly to what he's told them to do. So this verse reveals that Jesus' commission to the disciples was precisely the same as his father's was to him. I'm come to save the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Well, What was he doing here? Number one, he's discipling. He's discipling. He's teaching his disciples. They often don't understand him, and they often don't understand what he does. He tells them plainly, I have been sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That is the focus of my work. Now that isn't all, but that's all he tells them. He had commanded them. He's now standing in what he commanded them. God's plan was on track. Jesus was going to those he had been sent to go to. And as Paul would later declare to the Jews in Antioch, Pisidia, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing that ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. That's actually shadowed in this story. Jesus has gone from the promised land to the pagan land. And though it appears that he went there for rest and for no further problems with the religious leaders for the moment, it wasn't about to be a vacation. He's discipling his disciples, and he's teaching them something vital, because they will go out and minister to the Jews. Later, it will expand. So, Jesus' mission was to the Jews first, and he makes that absolutely clear by his meaning and the reason for his declaration. Well, at this point, the woman pleads again. She's not discouraged. She hasn't stopped. Her mother's heart may be pounding like a bass drum, but she hasn't left. The woman pleaded for help again, but Jesus rebuffed her. The idea of rebuffing somebody means not receiving them. The idea is turning them away, almost with a little bit of a nuance of just rejection, maybe even a little insult. Is this not a pitiful sight? Her mother's heart, her deep love for her daughter, continued to press her to call on Christ again. But her daughter's deliverance is not all that was in her heart. She knew that Jesus was the only hope for her daughter's deliverance. She wasn't going to stop because this was her hope. And this is amplified by the fact that the woman knelt before Jesus pleading for help. This is a heart-rending passage if you spend a little time with it. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. Such an image must soften even the hardest heart. We'd think. This woman, the idea of worshiping here, again, can simply mean reverencing, respecting. But the word also means on your knees. She's on her knees before him. Help me, Lord. There it is again. Lord. Whatever she understood, we're not imagining deep theology here for her as such, but whatever she understood, she knew, and she believed, and she was immovable in that desire that Jesus had the power to cast out devils. And this was her hope. You've said that before. Yes. And I'm going to say it again, because that's at the heart of the entire message of this passage. Not giving up in the presence of the only hope you have. as this pagan bows before a Jew, we've got to get this picture, as this pagan perhaps prostrates herself on the ground before this Jew, whom she proclaims to be the Christ, we see again one of the reasons Matthew puts the story here. Always ask yourself when you're reading the Gospels, why does the inspired author put this story here? Mark puts it in a different place. Luke may not even mention it. Why here? Well, this is Matthew's method. As I've said from very early on in our studies, Matthew is a master of contrast. Sharp, light and dark contrast. No fuzzy stuff. And that's what he's doing right here. He places this in direct opposition to verses 1 through 20, where God's people, quotation marks, won't bow. And here's a pagan on her knees, on her face before Christ, calling him Son of David. A pagan woman on pagan land crying out to the Jews' Messiah. What a picture. Hey, all of our backgrounds are ultimately somewhere rooted in paganism. Some of us blessedly had Christian parents, and some can look back a few generations and see Christians. Praise the Lord. But many of us don't have that beautiful treasure. This offers hope. This is not a woman with a bloodline that can be traced back to the 12 patriarchs. This is a woman who's probably the very generation before her, and probably including herself, are nothing but demon-worshipping pagans. And here's a pagan on her face before the Jews rejected Messiah. Why would Matthew tell us that? Why would he paint that picture this way? Because Jesus is preparing the disciples, and Matthew is preparing his Jewish readers for the startling conclusion of his book. Jesus is going to send the good news to the whole world, meaning to all the pagans. That doesn't register with many in the Jewish community. Matthew has been slowly bringing Gentiles into his story through the entire book. I'll talk about that just before we end. But now let's get this. She's before Christ. She's pleading for help. And here we have that stark contrast of Jewish leaders who did not repent, did not believe in the Christ, and did not bow at his feet as they should have, and as this pagan woman is doing. And this should give us hope. This should give us great hope. I don't think we have any Jews here. Maybe we do. Well, then Jesus then greatly tested her faith. Wait, he hasn't already? It goes even further. Jesus' next answer must have been astonishing, even to his disciples. It is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Now, some commentators try to soften this up. You know, they say, well, you know, he's not calling her like an old mangy dog that's just running around in a pack outside the city walls. You know, these were little trained dogs that were always in the house, and, you know, little pets that everybody loved, and, you know, they would throw a little food to them and stuff like that. Well, you know, if that makes you feel better, that's great. But he still referred to her as a dog. That is just shocking. And throughout the Bible, that's an insult. There are God's people and the dogs. And the Jews often thought this way. Gentiles were simply dogs. Is this not astonishing, brethren? This is one of the most amazing passages to me in the gospel. We have seen Jesus with a heart that seems bigger than the universe. And yet now there's a woman before him crying out in mercy. He's ignored her. He's let her know indirectly what his primary mission is, and it's to the Jews, not to Canaanite women. And now he says, well, it isn't fitting for me to take the children's food. That's covenant language. The children of the covenant, those that were in the Abrahamic promises, it's not right for me to take their food and throw it to those that are not in the covenant, the dogs. What was her response? Truth, Lord. Truth, Lord. Yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. The dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. She accepted Christ's hard language and adapted it to herself. That is a humble heart. We're so full of pride. If someone says something untrue about us, we go ballistic. Where if we had heart like this woman, when people would say bad things about us, we would say, truth. As a matter of fact, it's probably a lot worse than you know. But Christ has loved me and saved me, and I rest upon his promise. There's real humility here. She doesn't fight. She continues to look to him as her only hope. And Christ recognized her great faith, and her heart's desire. This is the second time great faith has appeared in a Gentile. That's really an important part of Matthew's story. The first time we hear about great faith is a Roman centurion. Not the disciples, not Peter, not even Matthew. Certainly, none of the religious leaders. A Roman centurion, one of their oppressors. I haven't seen such great faith in all Israel. And now, he says in front of his disciples, whom he's still discipling, great is your faith. As you've desired, so it'll be. While she was not of God's people by bloodline, she showed by her faith that she was God's daughter by faith in Christ. That's it. Jesus, at that point, is talking to her. Jesus recognizes and, I believe, has been provoking that wrath. Excuse me, provoking that faith in her. He has tested her faith as the Lord does throughout the Old Testament. He constantly tested faith. Abraham, you finally have that boy. Now take him up on the mountain and sacrifice him. Those are hard words. But he constantly tests the faith of those who in reality are theirs. That belong to the Father, belong to the Son, belong to the Holy Spirit. And my dear children and my brothers and sisters in Christ, that beautiful last sentence, her daughter was made whole from that very hour, is the fruit of faith. Now that's what we want to lay hold of. And we want to make some quick applications to that. This remarkable passage and this Gentile woman not only stand in sharp contrast to the unbelieving Jews, but as I said, it prepares Christ's Jewish disciples and us for the Great Commission to all nations. If you read the book of Acts carefully, you will see that this was the problem that the Jews had all the way through. You're bringing in the Gentiles? You're bringing in the Gentiles? No, you've got. If you want to be among God's people, you've got to become a good Jew. You can believe on Jesus, but you've got to become a good Jew. You've got to be circumcised. You've got to keep all the law of Moses, etc., etc. No, they couldn't get it. Jesus and Matthew preparing. Jesus was preparing his disciples for what he was going to tell them. Matthew is preparing his Jewish readers and even us for what Christ is doing. He is testing a woman's faith and bringing it to a shining like the sun. In other words, what turns out, what begins as perhaps the greatest affliction of her life becomes one of the greatest of God's blessings to her. So, Jesus said, "All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations." They were going to be taking this truth into pagan lands everywhere they went. And we should be doing the same thing. There is, if I can say it, there is Great Commission written all over this passage. Jesus said, "Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the earth, the end of the world." So let's consider these things. One, in light of what we've just said, in light of the time that we've spent in this passage, sometimes genuine faith appears where we least expect it. This is one of Christ's lessons to the disciples. A pagan woman in a pagan land humbles herself before the living God and is commended for it in the presence of his very Jewish disciples. You never know. Listen, brethren, we're all guilty of putting God in a little box. And be careful that you don't put God in a little Calvinism box and live in a world that ultimately becomes unbiblical. I believe and preach and defend the doctrines of grace, but I've seen people misunderstand it and wreck themselves. And I've seen the Lord raise up some folk that struggled with those particular doctrines, but who clearly walked in the obedience of God's blessed word out of sheer love for Christ. The only seed that should be on our t-shirt should be for Christ, not Calvin. I'm not for t-shirts, okay? That's an illustration. All right, so we want to get this. Genuine faith appears sometimes where we least expect it. We should always be looking for the Lord to do things that don't quite fit up with everything we've learned from all of our books. Secondly, sometimes Jesus erects barriers, not to drive us away, but to draw persevering faith in. Jesus put those walls up as he was calling disciples. And there were those that he essentially didn't give the time of day. And they didn't persevere. They went on. Listen, if you can leave Jesus, you will. But he may put you in such bone-crushing, heart-crushing situations, you'd think he's left me. He doesn't love me. When in fact, he's drawing you out of yourself to him. Sometimes he erects those barriers, never to drive his children away, but to polish and to fine-tune their faith. If you can read this book and come away with the idea that God's people don't suffer, I can't understand what language you're reading. No one escapes suffering, and it comes directly from the hand of our loving Father. And that leads us to number three. Sometimes our greatest afflictions prove to be God's great blessings in disguise. Brethren, I can look back and I can see sorrows in some of the churches that I was in, things that bent me, broke me. Crushed me beyond words. And I can look back now and say, thank you for teaching me. Thank you for bringing me through that. I'm constantly telling believers, and this always gets me, not going after anybody in particular here, but just saying, we go, yeah, God's sovereign. And then he acts sovereignly. He brings something into your life, and it's like, I don't get this. Oh, man, I don't understand. Wow, what's going on? Welcome to Arminian land. Mm-hmm. Welcome to unbelief. God owes you and me, owes us nothing but wrath. But in Christ, his eternal purpose is to make us like his Son. And you know that for some of us, that means some serious, serious work. Some of us just have to be broken in pieces before we're useful for 1 second to Christ. And then you find out his delight is to use broken people. Why did I go through this? Why is this happening to me? Because I can tell everybody why you're suffering. At one level, I can tell everybody here, if you are regenerate, you are suffering because God is not going to finish with you until you're like Christ. And for us, that usually means a great deal of suffering. Wait, I want some good news. It's great news. Because Christ will be with you every step of the way. And when the time comes, you will look back and say, you know, that was the darkest hour of my life. But there were days when I knew Christ and his presence and his glory like never before. I like comfort. But sometimes we're going to suffer. Well, my children, well, that's in God's hands. You're not going to fix them. You can't reach in one of their hearts and change it. Not one. But you know what you can do? You can come relentlessly to the one who can. That's what this woman's doing. My daughter. Silence. My daughter. I've only come for the Jews. My daughter. Great is your faith. What a glorious ending. Brethren, number four, understand and be encouraged. Hear me, as we begin the new year, everything here appears here as a New Year's message. Let us understand and be encouraged that persevering faith in Christ is always the key to our prayers being heard. What do we have before us? A woman that absolutely wouldn't quit. Well, that sounds like something else that Jesus taught. How about the importunate widow who kept coming to the judge's house? Help me, help me, help me. I'm the judge. I don't need this. But she keeps coming to me. Jesus taught us this. Brethren, you have problems in your family? Keep coming to Christ. Pastor, can you help me? Yes. Are you listening? Go to Christ. That's the answer. Keep going to Christ. Keep pleading with Christ. Keep casting yourself upon the Lord of mercy and grace. Well, the elders from time to time can tell you things perhaps you weren't aware of, you weren't understanding a particular passage. We can help you with things, but I am telling you, nothing will change until you get real and deal with Christ. Get to Christ. That's what the woman, that's why I love this woman. Sweetheart, you understand how I'm saying that? I mean, this woman refused to be turned away. Men, we could learn something here very powerfully. Don't quit. Keep coming to Christ. Keep praying with all your heart. I will not guarantee you how he will answer, but I guarantee that he will. 5. Mothers, let every mother learn from this that Jesus hears persistent prayers of faith for their children. I'm not making you any promises. I cannot say that all of your children will be saved. That's my point. I mean, that's my hope. That's what I pray all the time. Children, I'm looking at you. I pray your names day in and day out. I won't embarrass any of you by using your names, but I say, Lord, save this one before she gets much older. Save this one before he gets very old. Oh, God, if it would please thee, deal with these children. Bring them up in the faith. I can't tell you what the fruit of that's going to be, but I know that Jesus Christ hears every word. Mothers, don't quit. Here is a mother. I can't even guess how many people before the throne of God's grace will be in heaven partially because of their faithful mother's prayers. Don't quit. No matter how discouraging it may be, pray. And finally, let every sinner know that Jesus hears the greatest sinners who humbly call on him. This is a pagan woman in a pagan land. We can't even imagine what her life had been like. But she came and cast herself before Christ and was commended for her great faith, something we still haven't heard and won't hear about the religious leaders in Christ's day. Every sinner, whatever the depth, blackness of your sins, listen, it's not in a little formula prayer. It's not in walking the aisle and shaking somebody's hand. It's not in just having some kind of emotional liver shiver. It's in getting to Christ. Get to Christ. Deal with him. Call on him. Repent of your sins and believe him. Cry out, Lord, O Son of David, have mercy on me. He came into this world to save sinners. So, brethren, as we begin this new year, let us learn much from this Gentile mother who adopted the Jews' Messiah as her own. From Matthew's genealogy to the wise men to the Roman centurion and to this woman, we find Matthew giving us small hints as to the great Gentile mission that the resurrected Lord of glory will command in the last chapter of this book. And let that be to us a great motivation and encouragement in 2017 to take the gospel in every way that the Lord opens the door for us. The pagan world contains some of our brothers and sisters. Let us get the gospel to them, that they might come and that they might manifest a heart like this pagan mother. Amen. Jesus, we thank thee for thy goodness and grace. Now, take these words. Use them to thy great glory. In Jesus' name, amen.